بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our lesson tonight, we'll be talking about wet wiping the khuff, the foot ghee. You know, the khuff is what you wear as a boot in your feet, and it would cover your feet, including your ankles. So what is below the ankles is not classified as proper khuff, the foot ghee. It must cover at least what you need to wash in wudu, which is the whole foot, including the ankles. That is called al-khuf, the foot ghee. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in many occasions, was wearing a type of foot ghee with the conditions that we're going to explain soon, inshallah. And when he wanted to make wudu, instead of washing his feet, he wiped the khuf. So he didn't take him off, and he was satisfied by wet wiping the khuf. This hadith was narrated by 70 companions. So 70 companions narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in wudu, in some occasions, wet wiped his khuf instead of washing his feet. So we call this Islamically a mutawatir hadith. Mutawatir, what has been narrated by a large number of people, to a large number of people, and those large number of people would in turn propagate this to another large number of people. So it would be impossible that they all agreed to fabricate such a thing. So once you know a big, large number of people narrated something to another big, large number, then those ones in turn propagated this to another large number, and so on. So throughout the chain, you have a large number who received the information from a large number and in turn conveyed to a large number, and so on. It would be impossible that they all agree to fabricate such a thing. We call this in religion al-hadith al-mutawatir. Al-mutawatir, that's the strongest type of hadith. Al-hadith al-mutawatir, the strongest type of hadith. And this hadith about wet wiping the khuf, the foot ghee, instead of washing the feet, was narrated by at least 70 companions. So it is a mutawatir hadith. However, there are conditions that must be met in order for one to be allowed to wet wipe the khuf instead of washing his feet. You have to be aware of these conditions if you were to wet wipe the khuf, the foot ghee, instead of washing your feet. Some people might hear that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to wipe the khuf in many occasions instead of washing his feet, and they rush and they start wet wiping on socks, wet wiping on maybe normal shoes and the like without satisfying the conditions. And that would be invalid, and the wudu will be invalid, and the prayer prayed with that invalid wudu will be invalid as well. So not once you hear something and you rush, you want to practice it without learning about the details of it and the conditions, the requisites, prerequisites. You have to learn about these before indulging in such an act. You have to learn about all the rules related to this manner. In our lesson tonight, inshallah, we'll be talking about this chapter, which is about wet wiping the khuf, the foot gear. Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' said, wet wiping the foot gear is permissible under three conditions. That one starts wearing them after being in a state of complete purification, tahara. That they would cover the obligatory parts of the foot to be washed in wudu, and that continuous walking would be possible with them. We're going to explain this. Then he said the resident wipes for a day and a night, and the traveler for 3 days with the nights. The duration begins from the time he becomes impure after wearing the foot gear. If he wipes while being a resident, then travels, or wipes while traveling, then becomes a resident, he continues wiping as a resident. Wiping is invalidated by three matters: by taking them off, the expiration of the duration, and the occurrence of whatever necessitates the ghusl. So this chapter is about wet wiping the foot gear in wudu instead of washing the feet. So first, wet wiping the khuf is permissible in wudu, not in ghusl, the purificatory bath. So when one is in a state of major ritual impurity and he had that foot gear on, he had to take him off to have the purificatory bath. So wet wiping the khuf is only permissible when making wudu, and instead of washing the feet, one would wet wipe the foot gear, the khuf. So it's an alternative of washing the feet. You can wet wipe the khuf. When the scholars use that term, it's permissible, to show that this is a facility. He doesn't have to do it. It's not better to do it. However, it is a facility. If someone is a traveler, for instance, let's talk about the traveler, and if he wants to perform wudu, and he needs to take off his boot, wash his feet, he might experience a hardship, although it's not that big hardship, but there is a hardship. It would be easier for him as a traveler when making wudu to wash the face, the hands, wet wipe the head, then wet wipe the foot gear. That would be easier. So that's why it is a facility. He doesn't have to do it, but it is a facility. And that means to wash his feet is better. To wash the feet is better, but this is a facility. One can do it for some reasons. The proof about the permissibility of wet wiping the khuf is taken from the hadith narrated by Imam Muslim through the route of Jarir, one of the companions, that he said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam making wudu and wet wiping on the footgear. And all the scholars have agreed unanimously that wet wiping the khuf is permissible whether the person is a resident of the town or a traveler. Whether it was done for a need, let us say in a very, very cold weather, so taking off the footgear, washing the feet, would cause a hardship for the person, so that's a need when it's very cold, or for other than this need, even if you don't have a need, a necessary need, still you can wet wipe the khuf instead of washing your feet. Even the lady that is staying at home, let us say she is having her iddah and she has to wait that period of time before she can remarry if she wants to after getting divorced, or after becoming a widow, she has to wait for a period of time. They call this iddah. For the divorced lady, 3 non-menstrual periods. And for the widow, 4 months and 10 days of the lunar months. So during that period of time, even if she is staying at home, she still can wet wipe the khuf instead of washing the feet. If there is someone who is paralyzed, he's unable to walk, that would be a facility for him to wet wipe the khuf instead of taking off his shoes or washing the feet. You know, the one who is paralyzed on wheelchair, he would experience a hardship to wash his feet. But if he has, let us say, a container and he's using some water from a bottle to wash the face, the hands, wet wipe the head, that's easy. But the feet would be a problem for him. He can wet wipe the khuf instead of washing his feet. That would be a facility. So whether you have a need, whether there is a hardship or there is no hardship, you can still wet wipe the khuf instead of washing your feet. So from the hadith, we know that it is permissible to wet wipe the khuf instead of washing the feet. Al-Hasan al-Basri said that 70 companions of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wet wiped the khuf instead of washing his feet. So a large number of companions mentioned that they witnessed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wet wiping the khuf instead of washing his feet. So it is called what? A mutawatir hadith. However, there are conditions that we need to talk about. Number one, to wear them after having a complete tahara, complete purification. What we mean by this is that if one is in a state of major ritual impurity, he can't wet wipe on them. If one in a state of minor ritual impurity, let us say he doesn't have wudu, so he put on his boot in the morning, he doesn't have wudu, then he went to work, he can't wet wipe on him because he didn't put him on while having a complete purification. He must have worn them after having a complete purification. So I'll give you one example. Let us say one woke up at 6 o'clock in the morning, performed wudu, prayed subuh, then he put on the boot, like the safety boot you use now for work, that will be covering the ankles, and that would be sufficient. He put on his boots and he went to work. So he put them on while having a complete purification. Now at work, let us say at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, his wudu became invalidated, Then at 1 o'clock he wanted to pray Zuhr. So when intending to make wudu, he would wash his face with the intention of making wudu, would wash his hands up to and including the elbows, would wet wipe his head, and instead of taking the boots off and washing his feet, he can just wet wipe the khuf. And we're gonna explain how it is done, inshallah, shortly. But he must have worn them while having a complete purification. Like the scholars would give some examples that would be interesting. And some of them are like riddles. If you were to think about them, what he should do, it's subhanAllah something that you need to think about it. Like for instance, if someone was making wudu and he washed his right foot, then he dried it up, then he put on his boot. So did he wear it on complete purification? No. Still he has to wash the left foot. Then he washed the left foot, dried it up, then he put on his boot. So he didn't wear both of them while having complete purification. So he can't wet wipe on them later. So what does he need to do in that case? Many people would think, yeah, would take him off, wash his feet, whatever. No, he doesn't have to. Actually, the left boot was worn on complete purification, but not the right foot. Only the left was worn while having a complete purification, not the right foot. So all what he needs to do, he would take off his right boot, then put it back on. That's it. In that case, he would be considered as he wore him on complete purification. So that's something important, that he must wear him while having a complete purification. The second condition, the khuf must be durable for the errands of the traveler. They can bear the errands done by the traveler whenever he is loading his luggage on his camel, let us say, or horse, for instance, or when he is stopping for a rest. When usually one stops for a rest, what he would be in need of? Getting some water, feeding the animal that he is riding. So he will have some errands around to do, and that khuf must be suitable for these errands. And the scholars said in that case, if it is very thin, like socks, the thin socks, that wouldn't be durable for these needs. So it won't be sufficient. If one, let us say, put plastic bags, so that won't be sufficient for these errands when he is having a rest, getting some stuff for his animal, loading, unloading, for all these needs, they can't tolerate, they will rip. So in that case, they are not sufficient. Sometimes they might not be suitable because what? Because they are very heavy. Let us say some boots made from metal. That can tolerate, but he cannot tolerate making all these errands while wearing metal boots, all of them. Or made of wood. Made of wood. Thick wood, like, and he's wearing them. He won't be able to do all these errands while wearing that boot. So that would be insufficient. So it should be suitable for these needs. He would be able to perform all these errands while wearing that type of boot. So it shouldn't be very thin, like plastic bag, for instance. It shouldn't be very thick, like something made of metal or wood, for instance. Also, it must be waterproof, meaning it doesn't allow water to penetrate through it, through his feet. And that will exclude what? Socks. Socks are not, even thick socks, they cannot prevent water from penetrating through and reaching the feet. So if one were to pour water on his thick socks, water will go inside, will be absorbed and will go inside, so that will be insufficient. So the thick socks are not sufficient in that case. Also, it must cover the whole part that must be washed when making wudu. If you were to wash your feet, you wash the whole feet, including the ankles, you wash them. So that khuf must cover your whole foot, including the ankles. So even if you can see from the top, that's exempted. If you're wearing now a long boot, even if it goes above your ankles, maybe you can see your ankles from the top, that's exempted. That is still sufficient. But from the sides and from underneath, it's not tripped. It's covering your whole foot from all the sides, but not from the top. So you might say, if I put water from the top, the water will go inside. Yeah, that's not what is meant. What they mean, if you put on your foot, water won't go through to your foot. That's something you keep in mind. Also, it must be, that's the fourth one, must be pure. So if you are wearing boots made of filthy, najis leather, it's invalid. Made of pig leather, you can't wet wipe on it. You have to take him off. The skin that hasn't been purified. We mentioned in the past, how can you make the skin of a dead animal pure other than the skin of the pig and the skin of the dog, because that cannot be purified in any way. Let us say you found a dead tiger, you found a dead cow, already dead. You can benefit by its leather, the skin. You can purify it, you can make it pure. And we mentioned in a chapter before how to make it pure. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَوْ انْتَفَعْتُمْ بِإِهَابِهَا. You may benefit by its skin. Then they said, but it's najis, it's mayta, dead. So its skin is najis. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يُطَهِرُهُ الْمَاءُ وَالْقَرَزُ. Mean you can use a type of uprooting substance to get rid of the fat, the hair, whatever is stuck on it, you get rid of it, you remove them, then you wash that leather, it will be pure. Before doing this, the skin is najis. So for instance, let us say someone found a dead horse, cut a piece of its skin and made boot with it. It's najis. He didn't make it pure. So in that case, if he wet wipe on it, it's invalid. Must be pure. And let me, between the brackets, drive your attention to something very important. These days, most of the shoes, most of them, they are imported, they are using in them pig leather. And sometimes, I'm not talking about the synthetic leather. The synthetic is different. For ladies, for men, most of them, if they say genuine leather, and you see the lining in leather, the insole inside and something like that. In most cases, you might find pig leather inside that shoes. So you have to be cautious. And you should learn how to identify it. We mentioned the conditions that would make one able to wet wipe the khuf instead of washing his feet. They must be pure, the footgear must be pure. He must have worn them while having a complete purification, meaning after performing wudu. They must cover what one needs to wash in wudu of his feet, that means including his ankles. And they must be waterproof. They don't let water go inside, and also they must be suitable and they can bear the errands performed by the traveler when loading and unloading, when resting and the like, and continuing his travel. They must be suitable and able to bear all these things. Now, a person may ask, in cold weather we wear socks, then we wear khuf on top. Let us say the safety boot. I'm giving an example because you are familiar with this, most of you. The safety boot, usually it covers the ankles. You might be wearing socks underneath. Yeah, socks, can you wet wipe the socks instead of washing your feet? No. Are the socks considered as a suitable khuf, valid khuf? No. So when you have the boot on top and when you wet wipe on the khuf, that is sufficient. That is sufficient. If someone is wearing khuf and that khuf got ripped, but it's cold, he didn't want to take it off, so he wore another one on top. Another one that is suitable to be used as a khuf. And he wet wiped the top one because it's the suitable one that is sufficient as well. If he's wearing a suitable khuf and he put on top of it non-suitable khuf, so now the top one, you can't just wet wipe on it because it's insufficient. Maybe it's ripped, it doesn't cover the whole foot, including the ankles, but the one underneath it is suitable. Can you wet wipe the top one only now? So here you might put your hand, slip your hand inside underneath that top one and wet wipe the underneath one. That will be sufficient in that case. These are a few examples about this matter, just to keep in mind what you should do. Now, the judge Abu Shuja talks about the period of time that you are allowed to continue wet wiping the khuf instead of washing your feet, whether you are a resident or a traveler. According to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and that is taken from a hadith narrated by Abi Bakrata radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed the traveler to wet wipe for 3 days with the nights. That means 24 hours. And for the resident, 1 day and one night. That means 24 hours. After performing wudu. So this hadith, al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu authenticated it. He said about it, it is sahih. It's isnad, the chain of narrators is sahih. Al-Bukhari, may Allah raise his rank, said it is hasan, meaning it is authenticated, in other words. And from the Sahabi, the companion Safwan ibn Assal, may Allah raise his rank, said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to order us not as an obligation. He used to order us, if we are travelers, not to take off our footgear for 3 days with the nights, except for a state of major ritual impurity. Rather from urinating, from defecating, from sleeping, he would tell us to keep him on and wet wipe on him instead of washing our feet. So according to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, if one is a traveler, let us say, and he performed wudu, he put on the footgear on complete purification, then he established the travel. For how long he can continue wet wiping on him instead of washing his feet? 3 days and three nights. If he is a resident, for 1 day and one night. In what cases, as Safwan ibn Assad, the companion, mentioned, for urinating, because that will invalidate one's wudu. So he needs to make wudu now. For defecating, that will invalidate one's wudu. And for sleeping, someone has slept with the footgear on, he woke up for Fajr, and when he slept, he put them on while having complete purification. He slept, he woke up for Fajr, they are still on. Instead of washing his feet, he can do what? Wet wipe on them. Now maybe some of you start thinking about the aeroplane. Sometimes in the aeroplane, people might experience a hardship making wudu and washing the feet. So if they were proper khuff that satisfied all the conditions, then they can wet wipe on them instead of washing the feet. So that's regarding the period. When does it start? Al-Qadi Abu Shuja', may Allah raise his rank, mentioned that its time starts from the time he becomes in a state of ritual impurity after performing wudu, not from the time of wearing them. So that means, let us say, someone performed wudu at 6 o'clock, prayed subh, put them on, and he went to work. His wudu became invalidated at 10 o'clock in the morning. That when its time starts. If he is a resident, he has till 10 o'clock of the following day. As long as they keep him on, for each prayer, he can wet wipe on him instead of washing his feet. So from the time his wudu becomes invalidated, after wearing them, that's when he starts counting this period of time. 1 day and one night for the resident, 3 days and three nights for the traveler. From that time. And for the traveler to be allowed to wet wipe for 3 days and three nights, there is a condition as well, that his travel is not in disobedience. If his travel is sinful, then he cannot wet wipe on the khuf for 3 days and three nights. He would be allowed only to wet wipe on it for 1 day and one night, like the one who is a resident. Someone went to steal, so his travel is sinful. He's making a type of trade that is sinful. So he went to a different country for the purpose of trading with this sinful thing. So his travel is sinful. He cannot wet wipe for 3 days and three nights, rather for 1 day and one night as a resident. Then he mentioned, if he wet wipes the khuf while being a traveler, then resides in his hometown, or if he starts with wiping the khuf while being a resident, then he establishes a travel, he can wet wipe the khuf for one day and one night, as if he is a resident. So he was a traveler, then he became a resident, or he was a resident, then he became a traveler, he would do here for one day and one night only, not 3 days and three nights. If let us say he started wet wiping the khuf after establishing the travel, that means he's a traveler now. He can continue doing so for 3 days and three nights. But if he started in his hometown, then he established a travel, he will continue only for 1 day and one night. Now the minimum that is valid for wet wiping the khuf is what is called wet wiping. And it's the minimum that is called wet wiping the khuf. He doesn't have to wash the whole foot gi. He doesn't have to wet wipe it, all of it, but what is classified as wet wiping the khuf. And the wet wiping must be done from the top part of it, not from underneath. Wet wiping only the underneath section is invalid. However, what is recommended is to pass his left hand from underneath and the right hand from the top while making a distance between his fingers, so he's not sticking his fingers together. He would leave a distance between them and he would pass it on the top like this, and the left hand from the bottom. That's the best. But what is sufficient is to pass his wet fingers on his foot gear from the top like this. That's enough. This is called wet wiping. Wet wiping only the bottom part of the foot gear is insufficient. And that's why, subhanAllah, Imam Ali radiallahu anhu said a very, very nice statement. He said, لو كان الدين بالرأي لكان المسح على الخف من أسفله لا من أعلاه. If religion is based on opinion, people would have wet wiped the bottom part of the khuf, not the top part of it. Because a person may think by his own opinion, yeah, I'm stepping on it, so the bottom part is touching the ground, so I wet wipe on the bottom part. Maybe his opinion will lead him to thinking that I need to wet wipe the bottom part, when in fact this is invalid. In our religion, what is required of one is to wet wipe the top part, not the bottom part of it. So if you were to weigh the rules of the religion based on your mere opinion, you might say, yeah, I would wet wipe the khuf from underneath. And Imam Ali radiallahu anhu meant by this to give us a lesson, not to follow our mere opinions and the whimsical thoughts that people might follow instead of following the rules of the religion. Some super ignorant people these days might say, I think about every rule. I can make up the judgment by my own opinion. He thinks the rules of the religion can be deduced by the mere thoughts, which is not true. He won't be able to. How would a person know that for subh prayer, one would pray two rak'ahs, for zuhr four, for asr four, for maghrib three, for isha four, based on his own opinion? He won't be able to reach this fact. He won't be able to deduce by his thoughts and by his reason that I have to pray for subuh 2 rak'ahs, for zuhr 4, for maghrib 3. How would he know this? He can't. He must follow the rules of the religion. That's why if you know of someone who gives his own opinion about religious rules, you cannot trust him in taking the knowledge from him because he's following his opinions. I have my opinion. A person may give his opinion, but religion is not based on opinions. Otherwise, our religion will be lost. If everyone can give his own opinion about religion and it will be accepted, the religion will be lost by now. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the hadith, and this is amongst the signs of the day of judgment, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not order the knowledge to be withdrawn from the hearts of the scholars. Rather, the knowledge will lessen on earth by the deaths of the scholars. So the more of the scholars who die, the less knowledge you have on earth. And when you have less knowledge on earth, few scholars only on earth, this is amongst the signs of the day of judgment. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that, and once the existence of the scholars becomes very rare, people will take as leaders those who are ignorant. They ask them about religion and they give their own opinion and they become misguided and they lead others astray. So they misguide others and they become misguided themselves by issuing this wrong fatwa. So if you know of someone who gives his own opinion about religion, you cannot trust him. Even if he has a very long beard, that doesn't make him knowledgeable. Not every centimeter makes him so and so. It's not like that. Not if he's wearing that imama, the turban, the bigger, that means the more knowledge he has. It's not like this. So be courageous to ask, give me the proof. Who narrated this hadith? So I can check it. This is my religion. I want to make sure I'm learning the correct knowledge. Give me the proof. Don't be shy to ask when it comes to your religion, because that's the most important thing in your life. The last section, Qadi Abu Shuja' mentioned about the invalidators of wet wiping on the footgear. What will make it invalid to wet wipe on the footgear? To take them off, or when they get ripped. If they get ripped, that's it, you can't wet wipe on them anymore. If you take them off, then you put it back on, so you haven't wear them on tahara. Because the previous one, you wet wiped on them. Now you took them off, that's it. You need to, if you don't have wudu, you make wudu again, then you put them on while having complete tahara. And the expiration of the duration, meaning 24 hours for the one who is a resident, 3 days and 3 nights for the one who is a traveler, as we mentioned earlier. And the last, what necessitates the ghusl, what makes one in the state of major ritual impurity. And we mentioned that before, the emission of the mani, the sexual fluid, that makes one in the state of major ritual impurity. Having intercourse will make one in the state of major ritual impurity. Menstruation, postpartum bleeding, these matters make one in the state of major ritual impurity. So if any of these happens, that's it, one is not allowed to wet wipe on them. Anyway, for the menstruating lady, she will stop praying and she doesn't make wudu while she is in her menstruation period, and the postpartum bleeding woman as well, she doesn't make wudu. She cannot make wudu. She's not allowed to make wudu while in that case. And for the one, let us say, who slept and he woke up in a state of major ritual impurity due to the emission of the seminal liquid, in that case he has to take him off because he needs to have the purificatory bath. So he can't wet wipe on him. So wet wiping the khuf is only allowed for wudu, as we mentioned, with the conditions that we mentioned them as well. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.